Amen. Well, it's great to be together with all of you this morning. I hope you're ready to get into God's Word. Certainly over the next several weeks, you want to bring it down a little bit for me? Thanks. Certainly over the next several weeks, I want to make a shift in our focus as a church. I want to make a shift in how we approach worship services. Me coming up here for the lesson is not the center of why we're here. The center of why we're here is to worship Jesus together. And so we worship by singing with all our hearts. I'm going to help us take it a whole lot higher. And we worship together by taking communion together. See, the time of communion is a very sacred time. See, it's a time when you have sin, and you have things in your life that war against your relationship with God. And it's a time when you remember what Jesus did for you. And you take that sin, and you take those things, those attitudes maybe with somebody, and you put them to the side, and you forget about them, and you leave them at the footstool of Jesus Christ. And you go out clean. And so, then we take up contribution together. And it gets all quiet every time because you type money. Here's a newsflash. Money is the most talked about subject in the Bible. Because it's the thing that makes everybody get so quiet so quick. I don't need your money. I don't want your money. I get my little paycheck. People come up all the time. I forgot to give it. No, don't give it to me. I don't care. I ain't about all that. I get my paycheck and I go and I do my thing. And I give to the Lord too. And so I was out there tagging yesterday, you know.
Come on, Papa Ron.
And it was an amazing time. It was an amazing time. But we've got to understand what we come here to do in worship service is we come here to worship God. And we come to do it with all our might. Amen. So let's let nothing get in the way of that from this point forward as we go through. Amen. Today we're going to start a study of the book of 1 John. And so my other goal is that I don't have to get you fired up.
Come on, bro.
My other goal is that you get me fired up.
Woo!
That's the way it's supposed to work. You're supposed to have a great time with the Lord in the morning, great prayers, all this, and when I get up here, you're already fired up.
Come on, bro.
So I'm not going to be the guy who goes, is everybody fired up? Are you fired up? I'm not going to do that. Because that doesn't help you. That lets
Sorry.
You be fake. Right? Yeah. I don't want fake zeal. I want the real deal. So today, I hope, I do hope that the lesson does change your life, though.
Come on, yeah.
That's always my prayer, is that what comes out of God's Word changes every person's life in some way, shape, or form. And so, let's be turning to 1 John.
Come on, bro.
I'm going to give you the points of my lesson up front, and the scriptures that I'll be referencing so that you can better study it.
Come on.
The title of today's lesson is The Light of the World, because that's who you are.
Okay.
Now, the first point is going to be the words of life. And that's going to come from 1 John 1, verses 1 through 4. I'm also going to reference Genesis 1, verses 1 through 5, and 28 through 20, 24 through 28. Then our second point is, because this is our responsibility before God, to ensure that we have complete joy. Amen? And that's going to be just from one verse, 1 John 1, chapter 1, verse 4. Then as we move along to our third point, the third point is the light is good.
Amen.
1 John 1, 5 through 7. Our fourth point is about holiness. Of course, we all want to be holy, right?
Yes.
Holiness begins with confession. 1 John 1, 8 to chapter 2, verse 2.
Come on, bro.
And then we'll be closing up with our fifth point, total obedience. 1 John 2, 3 through 6. Let's begin in 1 John chapter 1, verse 1. Amen?
Yeah.
The light of the world. You know, Jesus said in John chapter 8, I am the light of the world. Walk with me. Come follow me. It's an amazing thing. Jesus himself never walked in darkness. Is that amazing?
Okay.
See, we forget. We go, oh, he's the Son of God. Of course he did. No. He came down on this earth, lowered himself down to that of a man, which like is an ant to God.
Right.
And walked as a man and never walked in darkness. He never had an attitude that he held on to. He always actually said everything that was on his heart and his mind. He just did it the way God said to do. So he was not restricted. But then he flipped the tables on us. In Matthew 5 verse 14 he says, "Now you are the light of the world. Now you walk like me. Now you live like this." And of course John wrote this book, 1 John. And of course he's one of the ones that dropped his net in Mark 1. Left his father, all the hired men in the fishing boat, and what left to follow Jesus.
Yeah.
He's one of the two sons of thunder. That's the nickname Jesus gave him.
Come on.
Well, why'd he do that? Because he was impetuous. He was ambitious. He was loud. He was a little bit of a hothead.
Oops.
And yet, in Luke 9, when the town, this Samaritan village didn't want to listen to the message, he goes, "Jesus, can I call fire down in heaven from these guys?" That's just the kind of guy John was. And yet, he also asked Jesus, "Of all things, can I sit at your right or your left, please? I don't care which one, just let me be right next to you." And so, I think the thing that most people kind of miss about John is that with all these crazy things going on with him, he was part of Jesus' inner circle of guys. He was one of his three closest friends and one of the three main disciples after the crucifixion. This is the disciple whom Jesus loved, the Bible says. This is the one, as much as he wanted to call fire down on heaven, he was like a son of thunder. This is the man that Jesus said, "Okay, I'm dying here. Mom, here's your son.
Come on, bro.
John, take care of my mother." He was a very loyal, reliable young man.
Yeah.
And then we know when he met Jesus, he was like a teenager age. He was the only one that Jesus revealed who the betrayer was to. He told everybody, "Oh, one of you's going to betray me." But he's the only one that Jesus revealed that information to. He's very special to Jesus. He's very close to Jesus. His mother, Salome, was actually the other woman that was at the cross with Jesus' mother. So we know not only was Jesus close to John, but John's mother was close to Jesus' mother and was there for her at her most trying moments. Now this book, when we get to chapter 2, you'll see he addresses the church, right, as my little children. That was the relationship he shared with the believers in this century. Calling them my little children suggests that he was advanced in years. And because since we know he was advanced in years, we know that there was a great persecution in 95 AD that came out. And the book speaks about relevant matters from the time frame, but doesn't mention this great persecution that undoubtedly would have been mentioned. And so we know it was probably written before 95 AD when that persecution came out. But most likely we think around 90 AD, which would have been around 60 years after Jesus was crucified. And so he's addressing great heresies that were coming into the church. Gnosticism was warring against the church. And Plato's teachings were invading the church. And we're going to come to find, as we read this first chapter here, there are three double engenders that he uses. And of course, a double engender being a phrase that has dual meaning. And you use them as both meanings in what you're writing. And so he uses the phrase, the words of life, which of course is undoubtedly to describe the Bible and its role in our life. And yet, the words of life also describe Jesus, and we'll see that in the opening statements of the chapter. He also talks about walking in the light. That's a good thing to do, right? And the double engender of walking in the light is, one, confession, two, obedience. And certainly we never want to replace obedience with just simply confessing and doing the same thing again. And so that's where it carries the double engender meaning for us in this chapter. And then he talks about walking in sin, which is a similar, kind of the opposite double engender, disobedience and not confessing our sins. Amen? Let's jump on in here. 1 John chapter 1, verse 1. The words of life. John says, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our own eyes, which we have looked Can you feel how he's recalling his times with Jesus? His own hands touching. He says, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared. We've seen it and testified to it. Amen. We proclaim to you the eternal life, which is with the Father and has appeared to us.
Come on.
Amen.
We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard. If you're visiting here today, it's because somebody's proclaiming to you what they've seen and what they've heard.
Yeah.
Come on.
Why? So that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship, check this out, is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It's interesting He chooses not to mention all of us. He says, we write this to you to make our joy complete.
Amen.
Wow. This is an interesting set of verses. Unmistakably similar to the opening of his other book, John. He says what we've heard. You know, it's interesting. We hear a lot of God's word.
Yeah.
We hear a lot of God's word. Even if we're not like digging in it every morning, digging, you can't get past being on Facebook and not hearing a few scriptures.
Right.
We've heard about Jesus.
Come on, brother.
We've heard that he died for our sins.
Yeah.
We heard that he lived a perfect life without sin. And we learned that he did a few other crazy things, like walk on water and a few things like that. But he also says, what we've seen with our own eyes. I want you to just take a moment to consider what God has allowed you to see with your own eyes.
Yeah.
Right here with him.
Come on.
I'll tell you, just last Sunday was an amazing service.
Yeah.
I mean, to have all of our region together, we were excited. Awesome. We got to see three people gain salvation.
Yeah,
we got to see three people go down under the water, have their faith put them in contact with the blood of Jesus, and come out, and the Holy Spirit literally rushed right on into them. And yet, if you don't speak about it, you're going to forget about it.
True.
If you don't speak about what you see and what you hear, you will forget it.
Amen.
You know, he says in verse 2,
come on.
He was with the Father and appeared to him. It's interesting when the word of life enters your life.
Yeah.
Don't you guys think Johnny and Veronica did a fantastic
yeah.
job?
Yeah.
Thank you for opening up your hearts to all of us.
Yeah.
I believe it really helped many connect to the cross when they took communion today.
Amen.
I thank you for that.
Amen.
See, he references Jesus being there from the beginning. Because at the beginning, the earth was dead. It was formless.
Come on.
It was shapeless. There was no life. And what were the first words that God spoke? What did they?
Let there be
light. It's interesting. It's just a phrase. But it's a phrase from God. Which makes all the difference in the world.
Right.
They're not just words. They're words of life. And if they created this earth, if they created out of the dust a man, if it took out of a man a rib and created a woman, what is it going to create in your heart?
Come on, bro.
What can it create that you need? See, your life was dead. Maybe some of us have come in and our life is still dead.
Wow.
You know? And that happens.
Yeah.
Here's the cool thing about all these people. Look around this room. We have all kinds of people in this room right
now,
right? All different races. Some rich, some poor.
More poor than rich.
And yet, here's something. If your life is dead right now, all of ours is dead too.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
All of ours is dead too. And every one of us is one or two decisions away from being dead all over again. And so there's nobody better than anyone here. There's nobody above anybody here.
Come on.
The only one above is you. That's it. See, but my life was dead. And then God sent these crazy little campus people talking to me about God.
Come on, bro.
And I was a philosophy major. This is at Fullerton Junior College in Fullerton in 1989. And these crazy kids, doggone it, if I even walked across the quad in the middle of campus, I could not get across the quad without one of these jokers talking to me about Jesus. And that's the way, I say it like that because that's how I was thinking. I'm a philosophy major. I'm trying to disprove God.
Come on, bro.
Alright? I hate God because my life was miserable. I hate God because I didn't want to be like my dad, just like Johnny didn't want to be like his dad. What the hell? How horrible to live like.
Yeah. Word.
What an empty life to live.
Word.
Yeah, talk about it, bro.
Now I want to be just like my dad in all the good ways.
Right.
Yeah. I honor my father. I hug him, I kiss him, we talk every couple of days. I love my dad with all my heart. That was only that way because of Jesus.
Come on.
I was a hateful young man. And then life came into my life. The words of life. Just even the little things that they shared with me on campus, I couldn't get it out of my heart and mind. It drove me mad, because I didn't want it there. I wanted to be angry, and I wanted to disprove God exists, and I wanted to be right about what I was going after. But it just doesn't work like that. You know? God's word, if it gets in you, it's impossible for God's word to get in you and not change you.
Yeah.
Hold the plate there and go to Genesis chapter 1.
Come on, bro.
Genesis chapter 1 and verse 5. I have to get a new Bible here, huh? Read the budget. Yeah. You just have enough, just fall apart.
Preach.
In Genesis 1, verse 5. God called the light day and the darkness night. And there was evening and there was morning, the first day. Verse 3 says, let there be light. It's funny. We forget this is how it works, right? When God said, let there be light, what happened? So isn't that amazing how that works? When God speaks, his words do what they're supposed to do. Going over to verse 24. And God said, let the land produce living creatures. Living creatures didn't come right after that. Because God's word does what it's supposed to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, he had a plan. This is an amazing thing. We might pick up on this. He had a plan for our life. Living creatures according to their kinds. Livestock. Creatures that move along the ground. Wild animals, according to its kind. And it was so. Well, of course it was so, because God said it. God made the wild animals according to their kind, and the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kind. But check this out. God saw that it was.
Amen.
See, when God's word gets into you, it's good. It's good. See, but what happens is we have little agendas that we have in our life. And when somebody hurts me, I just want to be mad. So God's word comes in and says, forgive. And I go, it ain't good. I ain't ready. But you can't stop it. It's going to happen.
Come on.
Now, you can fight it. And you may have a very strong will. You may be a very strong person.
Come on.
So you may fight it all the way to the last day.
Wow.
But there will be a day that you will forgive.
Yep.
When you stand before him, if you choose to not, if you choose hold on. Well, that day you'll forgive it. But then it'll be too late.
Yeah.
But his word will do what it's supposed to do. Let's go back to 1 John 1.
Come on, bro.
Come on, Ryan. Good, bro.
See, life appeared. Just like life appeared for me. And I fought it. And then in 1991, the word of life appeared in my mother's womb. And she came out to church. She actually flew all the way to Boston for church, because my cousin back there invited her. Went to one of these things called a Woman's Day, right? We just had an amazing one here a few weeks ago, right? And she came back from Boston and she would not shut up about church. So now I got these crazy campus kids, and then I got my own mother in our own home talking to me about Jesus and how good Jesus was. And I was like, yeah, I'm crazy. I don't have nothing to do with just Jesus, God. He failed me. He failed me when my dad beat me. He failed me when I went to ran to the pastor and he was drunk and didn't help me. He failed me. I hate this guy. But you know, then my mother started having people over to the house, and they're showing her scriptures, teaching her, and life is being created in her more and more. Because discipling is good too, right, guys? And then it got me. Then finally one of the guys said, "Don't you want to know what we're teaching your mother?" And I said, "You're doggone right, I want to know. I'm sick of this." And so I actually got into Bible studies to pull my mother out of the church. Because I'm a philosophy major.
Come on.
I know all these religions. I get her. Because I got her wrapped around my little finger. I'm mommy's boy.
Yeah.
God said, "Well, no, I already got you. Good try. Go ahead. Fight all you want. You're done." And plus she gave my phone number to like 300 people. And they would not stop calling. I cursed at them, I lied to them, I said I was going to show up, didn't show up, countless times. I told them my grandpa died, and the first time he had, the second time I told him he died, he's like, "Didn't your grandpa already die?" Liar. So, but then you know, somewhere around the study where we talk about the kingdom of God, he got me. I saw the Old Testament plan. I saw it match up with the New Testament plan. I saw God's plan for evangelizing the nations for the very first time.
Come on.
And then I looked around at these crazy campus kids. And I was like, man, they're doing it. They're crazy, but they're doing it. And I could not mistake the absolute commitment in their hearts.
Come on, bro.
I could not mistake the love that God created through His Word. The words of life call you to walk as Jesus walked.
There you go.
Come on. Here's the thing. The ideal is the standard.
Yeah.
We are to walk just like Jesus walked. Not kind of like Him. Not our own version of Him. We're called to walk exactly like Him. See, when you have fellowship with Jesus and the Father. See, because you notice right there, he talked about having fellowship with God and with Jesus. That should be our focus. See, many of us end up coming in here and we've not fellowshiped with God or Jesus. And we're looking for these people to make our joy complete. And to get us fired up and to get us happy. And yet, your primary fellowship is to be with God when you read His Word in the morning.
Come on.
Is to be with God when you pour your heart out in prayer to Him in the morning. When you cast all your anxieties on Him.
Come on.
That is the primary fellowship.
Okay.
And then, let's move on to our second point. When you have the right fellowship, then you can ensure that you have complete joy.
Come on, bro.
He says in verse 4, "We write this to make our joy complete."
Okay.
In the church, we can get too comfortable that somebody else's joy is complete and not mine.
Come on.
Or that mine's complete and yours isn't. And we feel okay with that. See, John wasn't okay with that. He said, "I'm going to tell you what you need to hear so that I can be fired up and you can be fired up and Jesus and God can be fired up because we're unified together." Complete joy.
Yeah.
It's something that I think many of us don't even really strive for. Just try and get a little joy. Okay. That's a great song. You fired up, I'm fired up. Okay, yeah. And then an hour later. It's not fired up.
I got a $400 liquor bill.
And yet, our joy is to be sustained continually through our relationship with God. Not our relationship with each other, and not how life is going. Because Jesus saved us, and that alone, that requires us. But you have to ensure that your joy is complete. And the only way to ensure it is to be right here in this book. The only way to ensure it is to be down on your knees in the Lord. Man, that was a shame. The Bible says a tree is known by its fruit.
Yeah.
And I had a bunch of young men over a few weeks ago, and I was like, let's get down and have a quiet time. We're reading, and okay, let's go pray. And I got down on my knees, and the guys looked like, whoa. I'm like, what? I don't really pray on my knees. Get out of here on your knees. Get on your knees right now. How can you have complete joy and never be on your knees? Mm. Bowing to Jesus now. Yeah. If you won't bow to him now, you won't bow before him then.
Yeah.
Bow to Jesus to have complete joy. I mean, there's many places in John 3:29-30, John the Baptist testified when Jesus came that his joy was complete because the Word is here.
Come on, brother.
In Deuteronomy 16, he says, the Lord will bless your harvest, see your work, and you'll have complete joy. John 16:24, ask and you will receive. And when you ask God and he gives you, you have complete joy in that moment. Philemon 6, he says, brothers, your love has made my joy complete. See, when Jesus comes into your life, you get this joy.
Yeah.
That comes from the gratitude of the salvation he's given you, nothing else.
Yeah.
Okay, you can get happy about other things, but that's got to be at the center right there, is that Jesus saved you from you.
Yeah.
He didn't save you from this world. He saved you from your response to this world.
Yeah.
He didn't save you from all these people. He saved you from you.
Yeah.
Hey,
amen. Come on, bro.
Amen.
Unless I'm the only one.
No.
I know he saved me from me, because I'll mess things up good.
Yeah. I'm a hot mess.
And I have.
And yet, if you won't talk about it, you'll forget it.
Yeah.
And so he gave you this word in your heart to change you and to save you. But you got to talk about it. You got to tell people.
Yeah.
See? You gotta have fellowship with each other. That comes from your fellowship with God.
Come on, bro.
You know, I was a car guy. I drag raced professionally. I had all these cars with loud stereos and everything. Every time I'd get a new car, I'd fire it up. That's what I'm talking about, my car. And you know anybody that's got a new car and just doesn't tell anybody? It's an amazing thing, right? You get a new car and you just want to tell everybody about it because you want to tell them so they go, ooh, oh, that's great. You go, yeah, fire that man. All those oohs and ahs make us feel good, you know? And yet, you didn't just get a car. You got salvation.
Come on.
You lived miserably and God just said, I don't even remember it.
Wow.
See, we got to walk like Jesus. You've sinned against me, and I don't even remember. That's a powerful way to live.
Yep.
That's a powerful way to live.
Come on.
Tell somebody about this new salvation. You go, well, I got it years ago. But Jesus said, I make all things new.
Come on, bro.
See, if you're not testifying, then there's nobody to share that joy with.
Yeah.
And God gives you enough joy, you can share it with as many people as you want.
Yeah.
How are your times with God?
Come on, bro.
Come on.
How are your times with God, really?
Yeah.
Are you really digging? Study. We gotta dig deep in God's Word. It is what changes everything.
Yeah.
There is nothing else that changes anything.
Come on, bro.
Only God's word changes. What about those who God used to bring life into your life?
Amen.
How's your relationship with those guys?
Come on, bro.
Thank you.
Are you sharing about Jesus and the incredible, crazy Jesus freaks that did it that they brought it to you? That's what we got yesterday, tagging. We're out there tagging, and you know, it was amazing what was created on this street corner on Los Angeles, right? People are driving by, honk, 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 yeah, Jesus, right? And then the muscle milk truck drives up. This big old red truck's got a big half bottle on top, you know? And Lay's like, muscle milk for everybody! You guys are awesome! Woo! She gave me her card, said, anytime you do this, call me, I'll bring muscle milk out to you.
Woo!
See, only Jesus does that. You wouldn't stand out here like that and have the muscle milk lady stop. That's Jesus. That's the word of life that's in you that's shining to this dark world.
Oh, yeah. Come on, bro.
You know, then the lunch truck guy goes driving by and he stops and we got buckets of money and then we got buckets with a bunch of burritos from the truck guy. Stop and get his burritos to feed him. You know, and then there's the one guy that comes walking up and he's like, Jesus didn't roll like that. He ain't poor. What are you begging for? What are you begging for? Jesus didn't roll like that. You should be ashamed of yourself. And I said, well, it's an interesting thing you say that. Because right? Jesus actually rolled just like this. He told his guys, no bag, no tunic, no sandals. Go out and get what you get from the people.
Come on, bro.
He took the Israelites and said, go see the Egyptians. I'm going to make them favorably disposed for you. I'm going to give you everything you need for this journey you're going to the promised land.
Come on.
And I told him, here's the thing. All that money right there, you see all that? Not one person here gets one dime of that money.
Come on.
Not one person. This is not for us, this is for the lost. Get to the exactly right. He said, well, you've been warned. And I said, well, thank you for the warning. I'll take that, and I got many other warnings coming at me. So. And then he called the police. And so then the police came on out. And the policeman got there, and he's like, hey, they told me this was like really bad, what you guys are doing. That you're like putting lives in danger. He goes, I kind of like what I see. He hung out for about 15 minutes, had himself a drink of water with us, and said, carry on. You guys are doing a great job. You know what I say? I ain't too proud to beg. When you got complete joy because of your relationship with God, then you bring complete joy with our fellowship, then we bring joy to the world. And then God's joy is complete. Amen? The light is good. John chapter 1 in verse 5.
Come on.
He says, this is the message. We have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. Now, if we claim to have fellowship with him, right? Yet walk in darkness, we what? We'll say it right there. See, God's got to speak to you on that. I don't want to call you a liar. But God just did. If you walk in darkness.
Come on.
He says, if you walk in the light, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have what?
Fellowship
with each other. And the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from not just some of your sin, not just most of your sin, purifies you from all of your sin. That's pretty awesome. I don't know about you, I don't think there's a better deal on the planet. You have a better deal than that?
No.
Sin up a storm, and okay, all gone. That's a great deal. The light is good. The light is good. Have you ever just like tried shutting off all the lights in a completely blocked off room? Just pitch black? You ever tried to walk around in a room like that? What happens? I mean, you kind of grope around, you're stumbling. And what's that produce in you? It makes you very tentative.
Yeah.
You're just like,
Right.
Makes you anxious.
Yeah.
Trip, you know, fall all over things. that you don't see coming. Sometimes we make decisions, we don't know what's coming.
Come on, bro.
Good, bro.
Eventually, you stand in the dark long enough, you start getting a little angry, you know what I mean? This stinks, man. Draw lights! I mean, are any of those things good?
No.
And yet, we come into the light and then choose darkness again.
Yeah. Come on, Ryan.
You know why? I'll tell you what, we're sheep.
Yeah.
That's why.
Yeah.
Notice I didn't say you're a sheep. We're sheep.
Yeah.
We're all built like this. And you know, it's an interesting thing. We want it to go away. We want to not have any problems. We want to not trip over anything. And at the end of the day, you know what? It is a lot of work to stay close to God.
Yeah.
And when we want all these things to go away, what we're really saying is, I don't want to have to work hard to have my relationship.
Come on, Ryan.
Yeah. I want you to take all these problems away so I don't need you anymore. Yeah. Then I'll be just fine on my own. And yet, it's an interesting thing about life. The right path in any decision is as clear as day.
Yeah, come on, bro.
The right decision is always as clear as day. And yet, and when you're walking with Jesus, you can see that path clearly.
Yeah.
Confidently.
Yeah.
No anxiousness.
Yes.
No tentativeness. No stumbling, no groping. Yeah. Just walking tall. Because you're a son or daughter of Jesus.
Amen.
He's actually your brother. That's pretty awesome. Hold your place, go to 1 Peter 2. Many think walking in the light is simply confessing our sin. And yet, it's not just confessing our sin, it's also obeying. Our society does not like obedience.
Nope.
I mean, our society hates obedience. Know what I'm saying? Everything is about do your own thing. Do what you feel. Do what you think. Take care of number one. You've been brainwashed, man. You've been straight up brainwashed. People look at churches and go, they brainwashed. No, the world brainwashes. The world teaches you to sit in the middle of sin and love it.
Yeah.
In 1 Peter chapter 2, you've got to understand what it means when the word of life comes into you, your life. You're chosen. It's not a mistake. Yes, the word of God comes to everybody at some point, but you're chosen to accept it. That's why you're here today. All too often, we don't sing with all of our heart, we don't worship with all of our heart, because we forget who we are. He says in verse 9, but you are a chosen people.
That's right.
Now, I'm going to speak to these kids of our members here. All right. You've been around a while, right? You're a chosen people too.
Come on, team.
Just like you're black or you're white or whatever, you're disciples.
Come on. Yeah.
That's who God made you. And fighting it, how's it working for you? How's it working for you fighting it? Suffering all the same anxieties, suffering all the same insecurities that the world suffers all the time.
Come on.
It ain't working for you. I'm so proud my son finally gave in.
Come on.
He had a lot going on under the hood there. Whoa, he confessed. Whoa. Praise Jesus. But it's your race. We are a nation.
Yeah.
We're not a church. We're a nation on this earth.
Wow. Come on, bro.
You're chosen people. And you're not just any people. You're a royal priesthood.
Yeah.
A holy nation.
Come on.
A people belonging to God.
Yeah.
And you can declare the praise of God. Into his wonderful light. It's not just any light. It's not fluorescent light. It's not incandescent light. It's God's light.
Come on.
It's God's light. Why would you ever want to walk out of that?
Yes, Brooklyn. Good job.
Come on.
We don't like it, but God makes rules.
Yep.
He says, if you're going to be my people, here's the rules.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right? We'll get on to it further in the book. He says, stop sinning.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, well, nobody's perfect, but you can stop hitting. Yeah. Right? You can stop cursing. You can live the rest of your life and never do that ever again. You're going to judge me when I do it? No, I'm going to forgive you when you do it, because I'll go to hell if I don't. That's the truth. Right? There's a security in being a part of God's family.
Yeah.
Right? Those who are faithful to God and go to heaven always forgive.
That's right.
So if I mess up, I'm going to apologize, and then you have to forgive. If you don't, then God takes you out, not me. I want you to stay. But we have to forgive. Otherwise, we choose darkness. Why are you going to choose darkness if somebody hurt you?
Right.
Well, think about that. Okay, forgive, heaven. Don't forgive, hell. And then you go, I got to keep doing it. Well, you keep doing it to Jesus, right?
Oh, yeah.
He changed his eyes on you yet. You keep doing it to him every day.
Oh, man.
We all need a number of people that are in our life that know everything. Right?
Yeah.
Not most things. Not just what you're comfortable with. Everything.
Come on.
I was over at my sister's house and her husband started going at me a little bit. He goes at me when I go over to visit. And it's pretty funny. And we were talking about confession. He was like, and of course he's comparing the other religions, what they teach about confession. He says, you got to confess to a priest. And I was like, yeah, you're right. You got to confess to a priest. And in 1 Peter 2:9, it says all believers are priests.
Come on,
that's what my Bible says. I don't know what book you're reading, but mine says everybody in my church are priests.
Come on.
So they're holy.
Yeah.
He's like, you don't share everything. Yeah, I do. No, you don't. Yeah, I do. No, you don't. I was like, okay, let's see how long this goes. Yeah, I do. No, you don't. Yeah, I do. No, you don't. I'm just going to keep saying it. He's like, all right, fine, whatever, liar. But we got to tell what's going on with us. Stop hiding.
Yeah, bro. Talk about it.
I mean, look at these people. What are these people going to do to you?
Right?
Can they send you to hell? Can they condemn your soul? Can they give you over to the second death? They can't do none of that. Then they might yell at me. Okay. Sticks and stones, they break. No. They don't. They have this thing called the armor of God. Nothing pierces them. So they can fire, nuclear bomb. I know, man. When you're walking with Jesus, you got the power. But he says, here's the flip side of it. If you have things hidden in your life, then you don't have fellowship.
Come on.
That's the truth. I wish it wasn't that way, but that's what my book says. It says if you have things hidden in your life that you ain't talking about, then you're walking in darkness and you don't have fellowship.
That's it.
Now here's the other thing. If you ain't focusing on God first and foremost, you're all about people, you don't have fellowship with us either.
That's it.
Right. So because this is about God, it's about fellowship with God and fellowship with Jesus.
Yeah.
And so we've got to really build the fellowship that the Bible says.
Right.
And if we do it God's way, we will have a fellowship that will create a never-ending zeal that you never, that you can't
Come
even imagine.
Come on, bro.
See, if you say you're a disciple of Jesus, right, and you're hiding things in your life. Now I'll just say it all right, because we read the scripture. That also means you're lost.
Come on, Ryan.
Right, that means you're lost.
Come on.
Yeah.
And maybe you've been baptized, and maybe you've got salvation, but you're still lost. You're walking toward death again.
Yeah.
Right. That's called being lost still, even if salvation's not gone. How can you say I have fellowship when you're walking away from everybody?
Come on, Ryan.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
Talk about it, bro.
In verse 7 right here, back in 1 John 4.
Woo!
He says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light. The Greek word, peripateo, which literally, the literal translation is to walk at large. Right? You're walking as if to prove something. With a purpose, with a meaning. See, walking in the light is a very purposeful thing. It's embarrassing to talk about sin. It's embarrassing to talk about the ugly things that we think and feel. But that's what we'll be judged off, the thoughts and attitudes of our heart. Yeah. And so if we don't talk through them, they just get deeper and deeper and deeper. And they turn back into action.
Come on. Yeah.
You've got to understand that purification brings holiness. That leads us to our fourth point. Holiness begins with confession.
Yeah.
Let's talk about this confession thing for a minute. Let's go to 1 John 1, verse 8.
Come on.
If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us.
Come on, bro. Come on, bro.
If we confess our sins, he is faithful. Right? So when our focus is our relationship with God and with Jesus, we confess our sins because he is faithful. Now the person we're telling may not be faithful. In fact, at some point, the person we're telling won't be faithful. And maybe they'll tell somebody inadvertently. Or maybe they won't be faithful with the information. Or maybe they won't tell us the truth. Or maybe they tell us their opinion instead of what the Bible says. But no matter if any of that happens, if I confess my sins, he is faithful and he will deal with whatever happens to people. Amen?
Amen.
He is faithful and just. So sometimes people get all open and they're like, I just hate this and hate that. And all this sin comes out. You go, you're in sin. And they're like, what? I'm just being real. But if you're keeping it real and the real is sin, then the Bible says God's just. See what I mean? He's just. So he still deals with you according to it.
Okay.
And so, yeah, get it out, vomit it out, and whatever, but realize what comes out. God is just.
That's right.
And so, he says here, he's just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. There's not anything you can say that you won't be purified by. He's faithful. He's just. He's compassionate. He's loving. He says, if we claim we've not sinned, we make him out to be a liar. And his word has no place in our lives. He says, my dear children, and he knows he's hitting them hard, right? And he's like, all right, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. That I'm hard on you so you won't sin. Do you want somebody that won't tell you the truth?
Nope.
Do you want somebody that'll let you stay in sin?
Nope.
And yet we avoid those people that tell us the truth most. Yeah. Exactly. You're like my dad. Then forgive your dad and you won't feel that way.
Oh, ooh, ooh.
That's how that works. Right?
Ooh. Ooh.
That's how that works. Now, I got baptized in 1993. And I forgave my dad with all my heart. And then in 94, my grandfather died. Right? And so I was like, we got to go see Grandpa. It was about a week before he died. And my dad said, yeah, you're right, we need to go. But we're going to go to Cabo and go fishing first and then go see him.
Should I hear you?
And I was like, no, we need to go see Grandpa like now. His foot's black. He's got diabetes. He's going. So my dad, he said, all right. And then he went and booked the tickets. He booked to go to Cabo first. So while we were fishing in Cabo, my grandfather passed. It all just came back. That one little thing that was deeper than I realized, I had to dig down deep.
Yeah.
The Bible says you got to dig down deep till you hit rock, right?
Come on. Yeah.
I dug down deep. It was my best, and I did forgive, but I was on hard dirt, not rock.
Yeah.
And every time, God will just throw a little water on it, let you find out you're on dirt.
Wow. Man.
And then slam you on down to rock. I had to really forgive my dad.
Yep.
Come on, bro.
Really
forgive.
Come
on, bro.
Thank you. The Bible doesn't lie. When it says honor your father and mother so that life will go well with you, the Bible means that.
Yeah.
My life totally changed after I began to honor my father.
Yeah,
the man who beat me, the man who used to take me with him to sleep around with other women, beat me if I told, call me the liar. That guy I forgive.
Come on, bro.
Now I can see this hardworking man who provided for his family, who had taken the shirt off his back, and I honor him for the great man that he is. Because all the good things about a man that I have came from him and Jesus.
Amen.
There's just a different way that you walk when you walk according to the way Jesus says.
Come on, bro.
He says, but if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father on earth, that's Jesus. Can you imagine that? What's going to happen? If you keep your faith, right? You get up there on the last day, and God's got his wrath ready to come down. Right? Because you deserve it. So do I. See, we deserve wrath. And God's ready to bring wrath on every single one of us. That's how judgment goes. But the ones who are faithful, Jesus himself. No! It's mine! Stop! He intercedes. He is on your defense. There's no better defense attorney than that. He's going to do that with us. I mean, we can't even call God a being or entity. We don't even know what to call him. He's so powerful. If he's going to do that with God, how much more will he do that with the people you confess to? How much more will he intercede and deal with things? Let's not be scared of people.
Yeah.
And thus hide our sin and hurt our lives.
Come on.
Holiness begins with confession. He says he's the righteous one. He's the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. See, we got to move on to maturity past all my problems and my issues. I've got Jesus and I still got issues. People out there have issues. People that don't have Jesus have issues. They walk right around us all day long. And we've got to get past our fear of people and confession and all this little stuff and get on to saving this world.
Come on,
we got to back this house out for people who really need Jesus. Who've never known what it's like to have the light of God shine on their life. Never know what it's like to be loved by a real believer who will really love you and forgive you and walk with you and teach you and train you and correct and admonish and whatever you need. It's what we do.
Come on.
See, when I saw that let me know what God's word was. That pulled me out of philosophy and all that garbage to teach me the truth.
Come on.
And it does the same for you.
Yeah.
He gives us a message of freedom, not of bondage.
Thank you, bro.
Yeah.
Hold your place there and turn to James 5. James 5, 16.
Awesome, bro.
Man, James likes the book of James.
Yeah, James is awesome. Come on, man.
James chapter 5. You know, why in the world would God make me have to talk to somebody else about my sin? Why would God set things up so that I got to tell some other sinner my sin? Is it bad enough mine? I got to mine his? I mean, why? How's that a good plan, God? Well, let's see. In James 5, verse 16, he says, therefore, confess your sins to each other. Inferring there's not just one priest. Right? And pray for each other. Why? So what's the purpose of confession? That means your sin hurts you. That means your sin damages you. It takes your spirit. It takes away your joy. This complete joy we're talking about, your sin is what removes it again. Right? It removes that joy, and it's just like a cut on your arm. And until you confess, it ain't healed.
Yeah.
Right?
Come on, Ron.
Isn't that funny? We see people and they got like a bandage and you're like, ugh. It's so obvious, right?
Yeah.
And yet we sin and then we claim we have it. We walk in and you're like bleeding all over the place. Oh, I ain't got no sin. I ain't got no problem. I'm good. And you're bleeding all over everybody. It's like, ugh. You know? Because you don't have any fellowship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you have no fellowship, that's how God looks at it. What are you doing? Just confess. They're nobody. You confess for me. You confess so they'll pray. And then when they pray, all of a sudden it's healed up.
Wow.
It's a magical thing that God created. That one sinner teach another sinner so that they have salvation, right? It doesn't come through them, but they teach about it. They divulge it. And then that same sinner confesses to another sinner who also has sin. What's that to produce? That we don't look down on each other.
Amen.
That we remember, I got sin too. We speak to one another as those who be judged. And then we give each other the truth again. And we hold each other by the hand. We lead one another back to the truth. I remember about 13 years after I got baptized, our church fell apart. And when the church fell apart, the first thing to go was what we call discipling, right? It's based on Matthew 28, verse 20. Teach each other to obey everything Jesus commanded. The charge to teach isn't just the charge for the preacher at the pulpit. The charge to teach is for every member to teach each other member how to obey Jesus.
Right.
Well, how can they teach me? They don't obey it fully either. That's exactly the point. That's exactly the point. The point is that we're a family who's there for each other, helping each other. And you know, that just kind of stopped going on within the church. And so there was no more discipling. And discipling is teaching, correcting, admonishing, rebuking, right? But what we forget about is it's encouragement, it's loving, it's forgiving, right? It's all of that combined. So in our congregation, let's not reduce discipling like, I got discipled. In other words, just use the word, I got correct. Usually when we say it because we didn't like it, right? I got discipled. Okay? Were you told a lie? No, I just told the truth. Then why don't you have joy?
That's
what we're supposed to produce.
Come on,
that just says you don't want to obey.
Come on, bro.
But you know, I drifted so much during those years. And I remember sitting in midweek service, and the guys are all sitting there, and everybody's talking about the Lakers game. And I was like, guys, I have sin. Like, I need to confess here. I need you guys to pray for me.
Yeah.
Like, oh, well, you know, you talk to God. We don't really do that anymore.
Wow.
Are you kidding me? And I left that night, unconfessed sin, and nobody praying for me.
Wow.
Sometimes we just choose to leave and don't really realize what we're walking away from. How am I going to heal now? God links us together to help one another.
Yeah.
You know, the healing is also dependent on the prayer.
Come on, bro.
Right? We confess to each other so we can pray.
Yes.
And the prayers heal us.
Yes. Yes.
It's an amazing thing that God set up.
Yeah.
And so what I did is I went and, so I'm a computer guy, right? I was a director of IT, so I got on my computer and I typed out all my sins. And I used like regular 10-point font, single space, and I typed them all out, 13 pages. 13 pages. I've been a disciple 13 years, 13 pages.
Wow.
When you really think about it, that's a page a year. That's all I can come up with. See, as we grow spiritually, I come up with a page for this last week.
Yeah.
That's how out of touch with my sin I was, is I can only get a page a year.
Wow.
And no one would hear it. No one would pray for me. And so I took that and I emailed it to 5 guys. And I said, please pray for me. These are my sins. Please read it. Please pray for all of this so I can be healed too. According to the way the Bible helps me to heal. Not one guy replied.
Wow.
Not one guy replied. We have to be grateful for the fellowship that we've got here.
Yeah.
Doggone if I didn't send it to Kip the King. And he got right on back to me. I read through it. I prayed for you, bro. I love you. Then I went to my computer and I go shift, delete, gone. You know, if you hit shift, then it doesn't go to recycle bin.
Oh.
Okay. You just hit delete, it goes to recycle bin. It's still sitting there. I want it gone. Shift, delete is gone. Wipe from our code.
Thanks, bro.
And then I, then you know, it's amazing. My joy was complete.
Amen.
I had peace. Because I knew from scriptures my sin was gone and I was going to heal.
Come on.
It's amazing. Don't make excuses why it's okay to lie and not confess your sin. In the famous words of Nike applied to confession, just do it. Let's go back to 1 John chapter 2. Our last point, total obedience.
Amen.
Total obedience. 1 John 2, verse 3. We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. Right? The man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar. And the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did. See, this was the second place John called us spiritual life. If we don't walk the way Jesus walked.
Come on.
Do you know why the world hates us? Because we're hypocrites at times.
Yeah.
It's the biggest reason why people don't want to come to church. It's our disobediences.
We
don't repent of. Coming up on here on Sunday after being in the club on Saturday. Skirt all up to here.
Talk about it, bro.
It ain't all good.
Ladies' night.
Good like that. What's that?
Ladies' night.
Ladies' night? No, Satan's night. But I look at that one and I have my sin too, you know? See, that's the thing in the family. You can talk about any sin when you don't sit above that person.
Yeah.
I got my sin. I'm an angry man, you know? I get angry about stuff. But we all fall. You know, even just a month ago, at any given time, I'm studying a number of things. I study, obviously, the scriptures. I'm usually studying on a particular book of the Bible that I'm breaking down to study. Also, a spiritual book to get deeper in a certain topic or whatnot. And then we have an array of study materials for the ICCM college that we have for studying for my master's degree. So at any given time, I'm studying through any one of those things.
Awesome.
Now, I have a tremendously challenging reading disorder that I don't retain what I read. I had one book, it's like 100 pages. I had to read it 28 times before I can even begin to answer any questions on it. And so reading's a big challenge. And you know, I'm a pastor though, I have to, right? I gotta hear it preach. I gotta push through whatever challenge is there, find every avenue that I have to overcome it. And God's faithful, he gives you ways. But you know, about a month ago, my times with the Lord, I was doing a lot of the study for ICCM, I was doing a lot of the book, but there's very little reading just for me personally.
Come on, bro. Yeah.
You know what I mean? But you know what that's called? That's called hypocrisy. Right? Studying more for other people what I'm going to teach than for me personally.
Right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think you should know that. I'm a human being. I sin. I have shortfalls. But I'm going to tell you when I did right.
Yeah, come on, bro.
And but you know what happened is, you have those people that are in your life and you know that God set them kind of as the authority figure in your life?
Yes.
Or one of the authority figures? Then, hey, we should have 2, 3, 4 people that are around us that have that kind of thing going on with us.
Yeah.
And, you know, I told everybody, but you know who I didn't tell? My main guy, Tim. I was embarrassed so I didn't tell Tim.
You better come on, Ryan.
You know, and it's an interesting thing. Over the weeks, because we have our discipling time, right? And we get our ministry training and all the stuff. And then somehow, magically, we just never hit that topic. You know how that goes? You go in, you go, oh, you know, I need to say this. And then you sit there for 2 hours, and then, all right, well, yeah, just, all right. See you later. And you're in darkness. And you're hiding. And you have no fellowship. They think they had fellowship, but you know you didn't.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's got to be total open.
Come on.
You know, as I began studying for everybody else to get ready for this, then this hit me. And I was like, oh, Lord, I can't teach this. I got to go confess. I call Tim up. I go, bro, I got something I got to talk about. My quiet time just haven't been great for me. And I failed everybody. And I just got to let you know.
Yeah, come on.
And then we had fellowship.
Yeah, come on.
You know what I missed out on for a month? Tim showing me forgiveness and love and grace. Mm-hmm. But the little spur to never do it again. You know what I mean? Yeah. See, we don't do it because we know the spurs come a little bit too, right?
Yeah.
We're going to hear the truth. So we fear that one. Yeah. We're all in the same place. There's nobody above anybody.
Come on, yeah.
But don't continue to do that if you're in that place today.
Word.
In that case, follow my example in this and
Word.
Get it out.
Word.
And get the training you need. Christians don't make excuses for their disobedience.
Come on, bro.
They repent.
Come on.
They honor God for dying for them, and they repent.
That's it.
And they give up what's going on. See, just testifying about Jesus, that ensures we have complete joy. But obeying the Word of God, disobeying it can steal that joy.
Yeah.
It can steal that joy right now. And then you're in this place where you share your faith with a whole bunch of people, and you're fired up, and people come to church. But then you're disobeying because you won't hold on against somebody.
Talk about it.
Come on, bro.
And you know, the way the Bible says, handle when you have something against somebody is very simple.
Yep.
It's in Luke 11, right, the Lord's Prayer. Forgive me my sins. Right?
Yeah.
But we forgive my sins, but we forget because I forgave everyone else.
Yep.
See, we forget that in other areas of Scripture says, if you don't forgive your brother, you are not forgiven. So then in the prayer we're supposed to say every single day, right? Forgive me my sins. It's tied to because I forgive.
Right.
Yeah.
Come on, bro.
And that disobedience can just undermine everything. And you could have great joy. But we got to stop undermining ourselves.
Amen.
So our great joy stays complete.
Amen.
As a chosen people today, as a royal priesthood, right? As a holy nation. I want you to make a decision today.
Come on, bro.
One, have the words of life. L. Two, ensure you have complete joy. I. Three, the light is good. G.
Come on.
Holiness begins with confession. H. And total obedience. T. Decide to be in the light. Live as children of the light.